All right. Oh, now here I'm on. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to church on this beautiful sunny day. I've heard that it's going to get cooler in the next week or two, so we can celebrate joyfully and with Thanksgiving that news. But for now, we are going to celebrate that we can all be here together again and welcome back Pastor Steve Bergeson and his wife Lynn. We are happy to have them. And thank you, Vanessa, for the beautiful harp prelude. We appreciate that. And, oh, yes, that deserves clapping. Yep. And welcome if you are joining us on Zoom. We appreciate having you with us as well. We are going to sing a song. We're going to sing a song that we have sang in the past, but we're still practicing it, so we could use your help. This is a song that we sing in rounds, so when the video comes up, this side will sing what's on the left side of the video, and this song will sing what's on the right side of the video. And let me come down here so you guys can see me. Greg, do you want to help me lead this? So let's see. You can take this side, and I'll take this side. So you three will watch Miss Dr. Greg, and you three will watch me, but we're all going to start out the same. So if you would please join us, and you guys can just sing. You don't have to do the motions. But if you're brave enough to do the motions, we invite you to join us as well. So remember this song about standing tall and when things change. It looks like we don't have sound again, guys. Have a seat. You also. Thank you. All right. We don't have, we have one set of brothers and sisters, but that's okay. All right. Let's put, can you help Sarah? Would that be okay? I have a puzzle for us today. And I'm going to give you each a puzzle to look at. Two, 3, 4. And you and Sarah work together on this puzzle, okay? Oh, maybe you can share with Alexander. He looks more willing to share. Alexander, can you and Matt share this? What I want you to look at is this pattern, and what they have is that pattern that's up there. So we want to find what's next. What's next? Now today we're talking about in Sunday school about the fact that we don't need to worry. So I want you to take a look at that for a little bit. And actually, I didn't plan this, but Pastor Steve is going to talk about not worrying either. And sometimes when we get a test or we have some pressure put on us, we tend to get a little anxious or worried, right? What if we don't get the right answer? What if I don't get it in time? So I'm going to give you like 3 more seconds for you to look at that and decide what the answer is. How many of you worry sometimes? Yeah? What about you guys? Look at all those people that worry sometimes. That's crazy. So you got the answer, right? No? That's okay. Here, let me give you a hint. I'll give you a hint. Use this to help. What about now? Sometimes when we worry, Alexander's like, sometimes when we worry, God has it all under control, right? Use these 2 pages together. God has it all planned out, right? And sometimes when we worry, we only have 1 piece of paper. Maybe we only have this sheet. But God doesn't give us all the answers. He has it planned out. But let me show you what happens if I do this. Do you know what the next answer is now? What's the next? What comes next, Lucas?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
What comes next? What comes next?
7.
What comes after 7?
8.
8.
Oh, I get it.
Good job. So if you put it halfway like this, it's much more clear now, right? So this is what happens in your life. Sometimes you have a problem that you're worried about, but God has the answer, and He just hasn't shown it to you yet. And when you see the answer, can you see that? It makes it all clear what was supposed to happen. Yep, the wrong way. There you go. Isn't that interesting? Now it's not a problem anymore, is it?
Do we have to make the 8?
Well, you can take it home and make the 8. How's that? Okay. All right. So let's pray. Are you ready? Dear Jesus, thank you so much for being in our lives. We worry too much and forget to ask you for help. Help us remember you're there in bad times and good times. We love you. Amen. Good job. Okay, now, do you want to go play or do you want to go with your mom? Okay, let's go play.
You know, those children's messages are often maybe the clearest presentation of God's love and gospel for the day, isn't it? Just thank you, Heather, for that. It was wonderful. Well, Lynn and I are delighted to be back with you again. Can't believe a whole week has gone by. And Pastor Bill, I got to tell you, I read the Desert Scrolls. Wow, is that good. So inspiring. And just right on point. So thank you for that. You just have so many wonderful things here at Desert Hope. And we're just thrilled to be a part of it for a little bit. So would you please stand at this time, and we will begin our time together to worship. We worship in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we come before you today seeking your word and your presence and your strength in uncertain times. And so we just ask, Holy Spirit, you'd fill us today with your presence and empower us to leave worship later this morning to go into the world and serve you. In your name we pray. Amen.
This is a Be My Echo song. It's a call and repeat song. So I'll sing, and then I ask you all to echo after me. And Vanessa is going to be singing the echo part with you all. Is it all right? Okay, let's sing.
Upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies.
Now all together,
the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. Be my echo again. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. Together, the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's take a moment now for silence and self-examination. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given us his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Master, let me walk with you in lonely paths of service true. Tell me your secret, help me to bear the strain of toil, the fret of care. Help me the slow of heart to move by some clear willing word of love. Teach me the way would be to stay and guide them in the homeward way. Teach me your patience, share with me a closer, dearer company. Faith sweet and strong, and trust that triumphs over all. In hope that sends a shining ray far down the future's broadening way. In peace that only you can give, with you, O Master.
The first reading this morning is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 25, beginning with verse 6. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well-refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The second reading this morning is from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4, beginning with verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say, rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. in any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Would you please stand for the reading of the gospel? Our gospel reading is recorded in Matthew, the 22nd chapter, beginning with the first verse. And again, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son and sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again, he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized the servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. The king was angry, and he sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you find.' And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to look at the guests, he saw there was a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and cast him into outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" This is the gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Here we go.
Let's sing. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, you're the center. Center of my life, Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, and nothing else matters. You're the center. Everything revolves around you, Jesus, you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. Jesus, be the center of your church. Jesus, be the center of your church. And every knee will bow, every tongue shall confess you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else but us. You're the center, everything revolves around you, Jesus, you.
Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Have you been watching the news? Not surprisingly, it's all negative, isn't it? I don't think the news media would know good news if it hit them in the face. They just like to dwell on the bad news. They say the sky is falling, and all it does is add apprehension and dread for us. That's not to say we don't have some serious problems. I mean, COVID is a real hazard, but it is getting better. The political unrest in our country is probably at the level last seen in the 1960s, and with an election coming in less than a month, there's already questions whether or not the results will be trustworthy, and we can believe what they are. And I've not yet even mentioned the word anxiety, but I'll get to that in a moment. I appreciate talking with people who've been around the block a few times. That's a polite way of saying I appreciate talking with older people who have the experience of living through other perilous times, and who know about resiliency. And they also know that with every new problem, there are also new opportunities. They do not say the challenges we face will be easy to endure, nor do they say it's not hurting people. They are hurting people. But they believe that God is still Lord of heaven and earth, and that our God is still in charge. And so this morning, I want to focus on just a few verses found in Philippians chapter 4. And the section, it begins with these words, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice." A wonderful verse, a hopeful verse, and a challenging verse. Did the Apostle Paul really mean always? Rejoice in the Lord always. Always covers a lot of situations, some which are not good. Maybe it's possible that Paul didn't understand the kind of trouble that we're in today. He didn't really know the depths of that kind of trouble. But that's not true either. As I mentioned last week, when Paul wrote these words, he was in prison in Rome. He'd been falsely accused in Jerusalem. And then on his way to Rome, he was shipwrecked, and yet he survived. When he arrived in Rome, he was put in house arrest, and later he was placed in shackles. Even though he was innocent, he lived life with uncertainty. He didn't know if his life would be spared. Every day, he didn't know if he's going to live or whether he would die. The Bible does not record what happened to Paul, but tradition says that he was put to death and he died as a Christian martyr. Paul did know about trouble. Paul did know about difficult situations, and yet he could pen these words, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice." Now, here's a question I've asked, and maybe you've asked it too. How do you ever achieve this? How do you rejoice always? Is it possible? Well, I think one of the reasons we ask this question is because we tend to think of joy in the same way we incorrectly often think about love, and that it's all really about our feelings, that love or joy are about our emotions and have little to do with our will. When we read Jesus' command that we're to love one another, maybe you've said to yourself, "That's a wonderful idea, but I can't do that unless I feel like it, and I don't always feel like it." What happens is that love or lack of love becomes a hostage to our feelings. I used to have a sign in my office that read, love is a decision. And I can't tell you how many couples, when they came into my office for premarital counseling, would see that sign and go, wow, that's really interesting. I never thought about love that way. Well, of course not, because in our culture, love is all about our emotions. It's all about romance, and I'm not against that. But love is far more than that. Love is a decision that you make whether you feel like it or not. I mentioned last night, if any of you are parents, you probably had the experience where you say to your child, I love you, I will always love you. I just don't like you very much right now. You know, but love is a decision to love. Pastor Alistair Begg, in a sermon on these verses of Philippians about joy, said that oftentimes we think that joy is to be determined by external factors over which we have no control. And therefore, this commandment from Paul to rejoice always just doesn't make any sense because we can't control these external factors. But he said, if you start, first of all, with what you know about God, that you know he is gracious, you know that he is merciful, you know that he is steadfast in his love for you in all circumstances, then you can face difficulties in life because you have the right thinking about God and you can rejoice always. True joy comes from above. True joy comes from heaven. True joy comes from God. There are many worldly imitations of joy, but they're fleeting, they're temporary. They're not permanently fulfilling. But we know that true joy is because it does come from God. He is the source of our joy. In Galatians, the Apostle Paul writes that joy is one of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. When we abide in Christ, when we know Christ, when we listen to Christ and trust Christ and allow him to direct our lives in both the good times and the hard times, we can know his joy. We can rejoice always. We need to distinguish between joy and happiness, because they are two different things. It's interesting, the Bible mentions joy or rejoicing 330 times. That's quite a few times. And it only mentions happiness 26 times. Oswald Chambers, who a great devotional writer, said this, happiness depends on what happens, joy does not. Because joy comes from God. Whether the times are good or difficult, we look to God and we can experience joy. One of the great confessions of faith about trusting God in a difficult time was written by the prophet Habakkuk. He wrote these words shortly before, or maybe just after, Judah had been captured by the Babylonians. And listen to what he wrote. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails, and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. Habakkuk is describing a rather desperate time, and yet his response was not dependent about how he felt about the situation. He knew who God is. His thinking about God was correct. He trusted that God is the giver of joy, so he could rejoice even in a very difficult situation. John Newton, the author of that great hymn, Amazing Grace, also wrote another hymn called Though Troubles Assail. Listen to a few words from that hymn. Though troubles assail and dangers affright, though friends should all fail and foes all unite, yet one thing secures us, whatever betide, the Scripture assures us, the Lord will provide. In other words, Newton here is calling for those who sung this hymn or those who read these words to understand the power of proper thinking about who God is. Like Habakkuk and Paul, he understands that when you have a proper understanding who God is in all situations, then you can also rejoice in those situations. Well, Paul follows this command to rejoice always with another command. Look at this one. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. What a great word for us to hear in a time like this that we're living in right now. In other words, Paul is saying we need to look up when we're troubled and not let anxiety get the best of us, but to look up. So I'm going to start with the last part of that verse where it says, let your requests be made known to God. You see, Paul had a perspective on God, or knew God, that God was greater than any problem we might have. And Paul knew that when trouble comes, the Christian needs to lift their eyes off the trouble and look upward and ask God for help. Paul knew that God would provide for us. Paul knew that God has a provision plan, you know, because Paul was steeped in the Bible. He knew the stories. He'd seen how God had acted in the past. He was confident that God would act that way in the present or in the future. Paul knew that story about Moses and how Moses led the people of Israel through the desert for 40 years. Talk about an anxious people. Boy, they were full of anxiety. They almost had just stepped across the Red Sea and they started to grumble and complain. They wanted to go back to Egypt. They were hungry. They said, in Egypt, at least we could eat. But Paul knew that in that story, God provided for them. He provided manna every morning and quail at night. God met their every need. And God will meet your need as well. Not being anxious begins with remembering. Remembering what God has done, what God can do, and what God will do. Each of you probably has your own God story. A story when you were maybe overwhelmed by a difficulty, and yet God moved into your life, and in a wondrous way, a miraculous way possibly, things changed, things got better. Well, it's important that you remember those stories. Don't forget those. Write them down. Tell them to other people, because when anxiety comes, if we can remember what God has done in the past, we can have a sense of confidence and assurance God's going to get us through this one as well. And so when you feel anxious, remind yourself that you're a child of God, and God will be with you, and God will give you his peace and his strength and his help. Anxiety and worry does absolutely no good, does it? I mean, we're tempted and we fall into that trap too often, but it does no good. It doesn't change or solve anything. But when we look up to God and we request his help, and then we rejoice that he is our God, that's the antidote to anxiety. Well, the rest of the verse tells us how we're to make our request. It says, with prayer, supplication, and thanksgiving. Let's look at prayer for just a moment. I don't know how many of you like to listen to Joyce Myers. I like to listen to her. I think she has some wonderful words from God to share with us. But she said that when trouble comes, what do we often do? We start to complain and grumble, and then we quickly call our friends so we can find sympathy and we can complain and grumble with them. Well, she says this, before you go to the phone, go to the throne. Pretty simple, isn't it? Not always simple to do, but really good advice. Again, when troubles come, we may need to share those with friends and seek their support and their help and their sympathy. But let's not start there. Let's start by going to God. Say, Lord, I need your help today. I often have people tell me they don't know how to pray. They've listened to other people pray, and they say, I can never pray as beautifully as that person prays. I can never pray. And I just share with them, here's what you need to do. Just talk to God. Just let him know what's troubling you. Share with him the good, the bad, the ugly. He can handle it. Just talk to God. Maybe for some of you, sitting still is kind of hard, and I just say, go for a walk. Find a great place to go for a walk and then just talk to God. Talk out loud to God. People might walk by and say, what is he or she doing here and talking about? But just pour out your soul to God. And for others, you can pray better if you are still. Well, find that quiet place where you won't be interrupted and just pour out your soul and ask God for his help. Prayer is bringing our needs before God. And if you're anxious, tell him why you're anxious. Sometimes you have to kind of sort through some layers of things. What is it that's causing me to worry and be anxious? But find that and tell him and ask him for his help. Well, it says we're also supposed to bring our requests with supplication. Well, supplication means to humbly and earnestly make our request. Supplication is prayer, often from the posture of kneeling, just literally getting down on our knees and humbling ourselves before God and asking Him to meet our needs. 11 years ago, I attended my first LCMC convention. LCMC is the association that Desert Hope belongs to and the church I belong to as well. But this first one, we were not yet members of LCMC, and our congregation was dealing with a lot of turmoil which brought about Desert Hope as well, so you know about that. And when I went there, there was a lot of anxiety. There were a lot of anxious pastors and church leaders. I was one of them. And the first night of the convention, for the opening worship service, all who were in attendance were told to take off their shoes. Well, that's kind of a strange request. And then everybody was told, because you're standing on holy ground. God is here tonight. We're standing on holy ground. We're in His presence. We're here to seek His power. And pastors and church leaders knelt and prayed and made supplication for help and wisdom for the days ahead, because we knew we had some hard times coming, and asked God for His strength and His presence and His power and His peace. That's supplication. It's just getting down before God and saying, Lord, I need Your help. We need Your help. Well, your own congregation went through that same strife, and so you also got to see, as a result of supplication, going before God, you got to see how God worked beautifully in your congregation. Finally, Paul says we're to make our request with thanksgiving. Thanksgiving, what is that? Well, it's a thankful heart that recognizes that God will always act with purpose, that He always fulfills His purpose, and He knows exactly what He's doing. God is never surprised. He acts with purpose, and He knows what He's doing. Imagine how differently our troubles would seem as if we looked at them as opportunities to see how God would fulfill His purpose. When there is a trouble, God will come alongside you. He wants to fulfill His purpose through you. If we looked at troubles that way, I think it would disarm our tendency to quickly become negative. Remind us that we do have a choice in our attitudes as we look to God. Most of life is outside of our control, but the one thing we can control is how we will choose our attitude as we look towards those problems, how we will choose to look to God for His strength and His help. I have a good friend who's got a cheery outlook on life, and he was once asked this, "Why are you always so joyful?" Here's what he said. "Because I'm thankful for what I have, and I don't worry about what I don't have." He just gave God thanks and praise for what he had. 7 years ago, another friend of mine and I were diagnosed just a few months apart with an aggressive cancer, same kind of cancer. And those of you who are cancer survivors know the anxiety that comes when you hear that diagnosis. It gets pretty dark for a while. Initially, it's overwhelming. Well, this mutual diagnosis that my friend and I had really bonded us together. We talked often. We compared treatments that we underwent together. We laughed at some of the absurdities we experienced in those treatments. Unfortunately, he did not respond to them as well as I have. 2 or 3 years after our diagnosis, he said to me, "Steve, cancer's the best thing that has ever happened to me." And I looked at him and said, "Jerry, I'm not there yet. I don't think I can say that. Why do you say that?" And here's what he said, "Because cancer has brought me closer to God." I cannot tell you how that statement of faith, I mean, I'm just looking into my friend's eyes and hearing him say that, how that humbled me. He was an example of a Christian who was looking up and rejoicing always. He knew he had a choice. He could become bitter or he could become better. He chose better. He could run from God because of the unfairness he was experiencing, or he could run closer to God. And that's what he chose. Listening to him and seeing the joy in his eyes, I knew that the anxiety he had had experienced in the past was no longer a struggle for him. He grew closer to God through prayer, supplication, and lots of thanksgiving. He believed that God always acts with purpose, and that he always fulfills his purpose, and that he knows exactly what he's doing. 2 days before my friend's death, which happened earlier this year, I visited with him. And here's what he said to me. "You know, Steve," he said, "it's really exciting, this journey I'm about to go on." Wow, what another beautiful and powerful statement of faith. And once again, I was absolutely humbled by him. But what he was saying to me was, "You don't have to worry about me." He was secure in the joy of knowing that he was a child of God and that he was going to heaven. The Apostle Paul said we are to make a request with thanksgiving. Well, what might that look like? What would a prayer with thanksgiving sound like? Well, it might sound something like this. "Lord, thank you that you are with me in this situation, for I know that I'm going to see you work supernaturally through it. Lord, thank you that you will give me the strength to deal with this problem and the ability to rejoice in you and your love for me. Lord, thank you for the people you're going to bring into my life because of this situation." When we make our request with prayer, supplication, and thanksgiving, Paul then writes this verse, "And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Our lives are always going to have problems. There will always be some troubles. You can count on it. I mean, that's part of the human condition. It's a part we don't like, but that's reality. You will experience losses, disappointments, disruptions in your plans, and the unfairness that is part and parcel of life. But God is always God. And God is unchanging. His love and his grace, they're always going to be constant for you. God will provide you with what you need. God will get you through whatever you are facing. And the peace of God will guard your hearts and your minds. So keep your eyes on him and rejoice always. Amen.
My shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not. Thank you. mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Please stand. And let us pray for the whole people of God and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, we pray for our nation right now, which is in great turmoil. We pray that your church will be a light in the darkness, calling the people of this country back to you. Lord, we do need to repent and come back to you, and we just pray that you'll stir the hearts of men and women, boys and girls across this nation. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for To-Go Christian Church and Pastor Aaron Scott. We ask, Lord, that you would draw their eyes upward towards you as they face their own challenges this week, whatever they might be, and be their strength, their hope, and their joy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Needing your mercy, needing your help with those people who are needy, for ourselves as well. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, we pray for Deborah Clausen, who has discovered that she has lung cancer. We pray also for Carol, who is recovering from a stroke, and for her husband, who has been diagnosed with cancer also. Lord, in your mercy, Father, we pray for Pastor Jim Cantule, who has been diagnosed with cancer, and for his wife, Patty, who is also fighting breast cancer. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, we pray for Brian Cheney, for recovery from injuries from this motorcycle accident. We pray for a quick recovery. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, we also pray for Christina, for recovery from multiple injuries from a car accident. Lord, in your mercy. For our Kip Thompson, for successful surgeries and for his recovery also. Lord, in your mercy. For Allison Porter and for Leslie Alton, for recovery from the COVID-19 virus. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, we have praise and thanksgiving for talking to you about our Francine Rienstra, who now is cancer-free after her treatments. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And Father, what a blessing to hear. So often we forget to thank you for what we have had answers for, but this is the sweetest blessing that someone named Bill Orgrosky wrote to us. He said that he loves our outdoor cross, our amphitheater, that he was biking on the loop and stopped to soak in the beauty as the sun rose. What a praise, Lord Jesus, to you. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And Father, we pray for peace and comfort for Aunt Beverly Shirk, Julie DeFrank, on her passing. Julie is her niece. Lord, in your mercy. Then we remember our long-term prayer list, Father, for Dan and Claudia O'Hearn, for their ongoing health issues, for Dalen Mickelson, for his aggressive brain cancer, as young as what he is, Lord. We pray for Don Schmidt, for his eradication of his cancer, for Greg Held, and for his mom and dad, Garnet and Mary Held, especially for Greg's hip and his pain there. We pray also for Haley Donahue, this baby that has been born with Down syndrome. We pray for the parents and for you, God, to give them good assurance that you are with them. For Isaac Paul, who's now 7 years old, Lord, we pray that his tumor, we continue to pray that his tumor will shrink. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our
prayer. And we finish also for Gene Santarelli and his cancer treatment also. Lord, in your mercy. And for our military prayer list, Father, we pray for Commander Brian Wilson, for Caleb Mayer. We pray for Seaman C.J. Campbell, for Lieutenant Connor Lovejoy, for Gunnery Sergeant Dan Patterson, for Specialist Isaac Sample. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. We commend to your hands, O Lord, all for whom we pray, trusting in your grace and your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's confess together now our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In the night in which he is betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and he gave thanks. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, he gave it for all to drink. And he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Would you please join me as we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Would you please take the wafer out of the little packet you have, and we will take that together. Take and eat. This is the body of Christ given for you. Take this and drink. This is the blood of Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Flow in the
bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
So we have a couple of announcements for you. Robbie, let's see the first one. So the first one is that we would encourage you to join Amazon Smile if you are a big Amazon purchaser. It's easy to do. You can talk to Lori. Wave your hand, Lori. Or you can talk to myself if you don't already have Desert Hope as your designated charity. I know my family orders a lot on Amazon. My son and soon-to-be daughter-in-law also order a lot from Amazon, and it's an easy way. It doesn't affect your purchase price at all, but money comes to the church. So it's a great way to support Desert Hope. Robbie, next one. There's a couple of you in here that this affects. Big World and Confirmation are not meeting this week. It's a fall break for the kids, so we're giving them the entire fall break to go do something. A lot of families leave, and just, I need a break. No, I'm just kidding. No. Well, actually, Lori wants me to work on my my budget, so I definitely need a time to do that. Desert Scrolls was great this week. If you have not read your Desert Scrolls, you have not gotten it, check your spam, your junk, whatever you call it on your computer, and if you still don't have it, call the office and we'll get it to you. I think that's it on that one. And then Lene talked to us last week, if you weren't here last week, about Serve Our City. That's gonna be November 15th. This is in conjunction with Pantano and John 17 and For Tucson. I heard that we might be working on Christmas stockings for homeless people. That's just a rumor. I don't know if that's what we've decided at the very end. So it's going to be something fun November 15th in the afternoon after church. We'd love for you to come. There'll be stuff to do outside on the patio. If you want to stay outside, there'll be maybe some inside things. We'll work it out, make sure everybody's happy. The other thing that we don't have a slide for is that our nursery is now open, and we'd love to have some volunteers in there. Yes, we have Angela as our nursery person, but we do need to have two people in there at all times per our child safety policy. So we'll be sending out, if you're already in the nursery care group, you'll get an email. And if you'd like to hang out with some of our friendliest brothers and sisters, we'd love to have you join us in there. Also, Big World, which is usually on Wednesday night, but not this week, would love to have some of you hang out with those kids too. Those are second through fifth graders. So we would love to have your help as a volunteer in there. Those are great kids. And I think that's it. Greg, it's all you.
Okay, please stand and let's sing.
One, two, here we go.
Giver of every breath I breathe, author of all eternity, giver of every perfect thing, to you be the glory. Maker of heaven and of earth, no one can comprehend your worth. King over all the universe, to you be the glory. I am alive because I'm alive in you, and it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because the blood of Jesus Christ that covers me and raised this dead man's life. All because of Jesus I'm alive. Giver of every breath I breathe, author of all eternity, your worth. King over all the universe, to you be the glory. And I am alive because I'm alive in you. And it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because the blood of Jesus Christ this dead man's life. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive.
Thank you. Well, once again, I want to thank you for your warm hospitality for Lynn and I. And with these masks we're wearing, it's hard to always greet everybody, but we'd sure like to visit with you when possible in the back or whatever. But thank you for being here today and supporting your church and coming to acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, isn't he? He's King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Now go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.